Linden Boulevard, represent, represent, Zen Tribe, Core Quest, represent, represent, when the mic is in my hand.
I never thought I'd be cool enough to walk out to Tribe Called Quest, but I got to pick the music, so what are you going to do? Hi, everybody. How was your first session in Fintech DevCon? Pretty good? Anybody, do me a favor, raise your hand if this is your first conference in like a year, year and a half. Awesome. That's why you guys are saying it's so good, because you're just excited to see people. Well, we're really excited to have you here at what I'm calling Charlie Ma's annual portfolio gathering. If you know him, that's a funny joke, because he seems to invest in every single company. But we're really thankful to have Charlie here. I told him I was going to tell a joke about him, and he said it's fine. So we're excited to have him here, have the entire panel talk about the business of APIs, even though he tweeted about it last week and said, can you send me questions for my panel next week? Or Monday, I'm not even sure. But so please, help me in welcoming. Let's stand and give the invitation to our panel. All righty. Well, let's kick it off. Should we do a quick round of introductions around the horn? Justin, want to kick us off?
Hey, everyone. I'm Justin Overdorf. I'm a current investing partner at Lightspeed, focused on fintech. Previous to that, I spent a long time at Stripe, where I led a bunch of partnerships efforts and go-to-market strategies.
Hi, everyone. Kara Hayward, Director of Strategic Partnerships for North America Currency Cloud. My job is to build partnerships and relationships with all the different ecosystem infrastructure players to mutually serve our fintech customers.
Hi, everyone. I'm P. Lord. I'm the CEO and co-founder at Kodak. We help our clients who are financial institutions and technology companies connect to the software used by their small business customers. So things like accounting software, Xero, QuickBooks Sage, e-commerce, point of sale, marketplaces.
Awesome. Hi, everyone. I'm Ryan, CEO and co-founder of TrueWork. We are building the modern credit bureau that doesn't suck. And today, we focus on income verification. We have over 15,000 lenders, including the largest banks in the country, who use our API to verify income on loans.
Awesome. Well, I wanted to kind of kick off the panel with some questions about starting go-to-market teams around APIs, around infrastructure. So the first one, which anyone can take, so what did your business teams initially look like when you started, and how that evolved over time as related to the product, too?
I can jump in.
Yeah.
Business team day one looked like this, me and my co-founders, and it's evolved over time as we've grown out. I think in terms of the team structure, we've split it in a few different dimensions. So firstly, by geography, just because it makes logistical sense to be in the same time zone as your clients. But then secondly, and probably the most importantly, is by the industries and use cases for our products. Mm. And that allows the people in those teams to become subject matter experts really quickly and to help educate our prospects that are considering using technology. And then as we've grown, we split again by the size of companies that are considering using us. The buying process for a startup just coming out of Y Combinator is very different from a large bank. And that means that we need to handhold them through exploring our products in slightly different ways.
Happy to add too. I joined Currency Cloud a little bit later in the stage, but in North America, which was an expansion strategy for us, we were very sales-led to begin with and kind of pretty broad in terms of who we serviced. But over time, we really added a lot of the support functions, social solutions teams, customer success, account management to really cradle to grave, essentially, with our clients. I also think we've also segmented and really focused on different unique areas to make sure that we become those subject matter experts, so very similar to what you're doing.
I think for Stripe, the kind of go-to-market motion was a little bit different in that, it's a very developer-led kind of go-to-market motion. And so as a result, when I joined,
there was actually not really a sales team. It was more internal sales of a couple people, and then there was a partnerships team that I was on. And so the way they kind of described the motion is you had two very small teams, mostly taking inbound from email signups, and then on the business development partnership function was really just more of a consultative process where we were kind of going out and trying to find platforms like Shopify, WooCommerce, Xero, et cetera, and trying to understand what the use cases they had. And so that motion of kind of like, being more of a product consultant versus a salesperson is, I think, a different motion, and I think generally works pretty well with APIs.
And actually, kind of going a little further on that, at what point did you all decide, particularly in the earlier stages, hey, we should bring in a business person, we should bring in a salesperson? So what was the trigger point, depending on what type of business? And then how did you all kind of start to think about at what point it made sense to start to scale and how you want to scale that?
Yeah, I mean, for us, I think it was first 7 customers that I sold until we started hiring salespeople. I think, as I mentioned, I mean, the founder selling the product in the early days is really important so that you know the customer very well. And I think only after you've gotten a little early traction, you start bringing in sales teams. I mean, now we have a large sales team, but I'd say it took us a good 6 months or a year until we hired our first sales hire.
Just Pete.
Yeah, ours was much sooner than that. Okay. Our strategy was to sell to large enterprises first, as opposed to a more developer-led self-serve motion, which is something we now have, but that came later for us. So certainly within, I think it was the first 6 months, we made our first sales hire.
Makes sense. And then kind of, what do you all look for when it comes to hiring people, business hires, whether it's early, mid-late, mid-stage, late-stage, sort of traits, qualities, how do you go about hiring those first few?
I'm going to start on that one. So I think curiosity is the biggest one, especially in the payments business. You have to peel away the onion time and time again. And just when you think you've gotten to a truth, you have to try it all over again. So that's a big one. I think attention to detail is also important, but also having that ability to then pull yourself out and think a bit more strategically. We also, we're very strong on our values, better together, be human, and own it. And I think we really love those values, too. And so we definitely look for that in our hiring.
I think at Stripe, and certainly by my experience kind of with other companies, I think product-led business people tend to be a lot more effective in the types of sales environments that we were kind of trying to cultivate. I think curiosity, as Kara said, is incredibly important. There's also some element of like actually being able to be technical from a business standpoint. You don't have to write code necessarily, but like, can you actually, use the API to some extent? Like, even a little, can you actually just, can you make an API call? It's not that difficult, right? And so, like, being able to do that makes your business approach a lot easier.
Yeah, we had a similar thing. I mean, when early on for Plaid, I think you can only apply via API, right? So there was some, at least you could send at least some sort of API request in order to actually get into the company.
Yeah, so I was going to say, it's raw horsepower, is what we say a lot. You have to be somewhat technical, as I just mentioned. You want to go into these sales and be a real expert to the customer. And there's no way you're going to be a real expert unless you've actually used API. You actually know how to test it yourself. And so, yeah, you definitely tend much more technical analytical than I think some other industries. And generally people that are really versatile. I mean, we have so many different types of products and they're changing all the time. And people are selling very, very different things. And the most versatile salespeople have been the most successful.
Sure. There's like a problem-solving element to it, too, like when it comes to the technical aspect or being able to be willing to be somewhat technical. Because as you're building a product that is infrastructure, a lot of times when things break, your support function at scale can't be the only face of the company to deal with issues. And so having salespeople or account managers that can actually do some of the maybe like minor debugging really adds a ton of value to customers because it shows that you as a business really understand their problems. And constantly always having to say like, well, wait, you have to sit in the support queue is a really bad experience, particularly because when downtime equals money for most companies.
So. Yeah, makes sense. I think we also talked about, I think, a little bit around the interactions that, your business team has to have with your product teams, your ops teams. Sort of how does your team sort of
business teams in particular work with, partner with the more technical product engineering teams. How has that changed over time?
If I can jump in, I think the most important thing in my mind is that your engineers understand your customers and the product and the problems that it's solving. So it's not just a ticket and a piece of code that they're working on, but they understand how that fits into the bigger picture. And that's very easy to achieve when you're a young company and you'll sit in the same room and you know each other well. But as you scale, you have to be more deliberate about making sure that there's that level of understanding in the team. As you know, when you bring in functions like BA or products that typically sit between your customers and your salespeople and the engineers themselves.
Yeah, we organize based on sort of a pod structure, and that's something that develops over time. It used to be that we kind of operated from more of a functional perspective, and that has really, really helped us get to the depths of our client stories. And so essentially it's a cross-functional participation across product, customer success, sales, SDRs, marketing, and we're taking those real client stories day to day, and then that's how the product team takes it back and prioritizes it based on that. So that's really, really helped us get way, way deeper into understanding our client stories and how to build out for each one.
Cool. I think kind of speaking about product development a little bit. Oftentimes, I think as companies start to reach scale, there comes the need to branch out into new verticals, new product areas, and kind of create other lines of revenue for the business. I'm curious as to how did your companies approach new product development? How are those teams structured from a business perspective, product engineering? What's worked? What didn't work?
Yeah, sure. I'm happy to answer. I think. At Stripe, the company was organized very functionally for a long time, and Stripe is somewhat famous that there weren't product managers for the first basically 5-6 years. So product was really developed and kind of led by the engineering team, and the thesis there was just look if you're building for engineers, you need engineers to build it, right? So that was kind of the thesis. But how things were organized, as the company scaled, certainly product managers come on board. But I think the thing that Stripe really did a great job with was sort of starting to create these kind of like a pod, but almost like these GM units of this product is going to be owned by this group. You have a set of people that are focused on that. And the decentralized decision-making that kind of went with that allowed the company to move pretty quickly, so instead of kind of having a top-down approach.
Yeah, I'd say it's all about feedback loops, which I think has been mentioned a lot here. Is there a feedback loop between engineering and sales and vice versa? And for us, oftentimes new products are coming from PMs or engineers, but without them getting that feedback and sitting in those customer meetings and really truly understanding the problems, they're not going to be able to come up with the right products. And so you really just have to have that type of feedback loop between both sides of the organization.
And just to add on to that, too, we have a very partnership-focused kind of go-to-market strategy as well. So oftentimes we realize that it might take, a couple years to build something ourselves, and so can we go test the market with a partner? So that's something that over the past few years we've done very well, I think. And so that's another way that we can, get some new products out there to test and then decide, where do we go from there. So
I think design partners, particularly for more earlier stage companies, I think design partners on the customer side are incredibly valuable to building long-term sustainable products that kind of branch out and can expand. They're invaluable. And so when you find great ones, don't lose them.
Actually, that's interesting. For Brian and Pete, how did you find your first design customers? Where did they come from? How did you kind of go about kind of cultivating that early customer base?
Yeah, I think oftentimes it is challenging because a lot of startups will start SMB and then go up enterprise.
Right.
You're trying to find kind of that golden enterprise to be your test customer of things, and it definitely could take some time. You have to find someone who's going to be willing to take a little bet on you. So I will say it came after some pretty significant SMB growth. We were able to show just how valuable the product was, get early traction with large enterprise, and convince them to partner more deeply and be a design partner. But it definitely was not easy. They're taking a very big risk on you, slowing down their own PD roadmap sometimes just to beta test something with you. So I'd say just as much traction and executive mindshare you can build within that design partner.
Yeah, for us, an example that comes to mind is iZettle. It's now owned by PayPal, and we essentially built a product for them in conjunction with them. We did that quite early on. Obviously, it's a big commitment in terms of developing something new for an enterprise, but it's definitely been successful, and you can get that live feedback from day one at scale, which is invaluable.
Awesome. And I want to kind of transition a little bit. I think something that's often underappreciated when it comes to new product development and businesses around building a business around APIs is pricing. I think it's a common thing that I've talked with founders as to, I think it actually makes sense to think a little bit earlier about pricing. But kind of curious around how do you sort of think about pricing APIs, SaaS fees, platform fees, seats, usage-based sort of, what type of approaches have you been taking? Have you sort of taken and experimented around just kind of pricing in general for your products?
I'll start on this one. It's been a journey. I think to start, we're in the cross-border business, right? So FX is a big piece, and volume charges, transaction charges is a big piece of how we can make money. And I think to start, there was the more analog world was used to, like, hey, it's just tack a spread on, right? Or rev share or something like that. And we started to go to market with that, but what we realized is oftentimes you weren't getting skin in the game from especially some of your earlier customers that maybe have never had a cross-border strategy before. And so that's where we started implementing more of a SaaS-based pricing model, which worked for a lot of our customers because it really put that kind of partnership lens on it and really both of us having that skin in the game and building something. But it still didn't work for every segment. So I think that segmentation, again, where we went into that kind of pod-based approach and saying who they're really servicing, what are they used to, are they in the space already or not, and like all asking all these questions is what really helped us then hone in on what our pricing strategy was going to be.
Yeah, I agree with all that, and I would say one thing I do see people miss is pricing low to start. If your product's not a commodity, start as high as you possibly can, and you'll go down over time. I mean, you'll see pressure on that price, but it allows you to capture much more upside earlier, allows you to fund other parts of your businesses, and so I see people come out with just a very low-priced product, and then I'm wondering why sometimes. And I think the second piece is transactional with SaaS for us. I mean, within banking and lenders especially, I think there's a lot of pushback about signing up for long-term subscription agreements, especially if they don't know how to predict their volume over the next few years. Just because there's pushback doesn't mean they won't. And for the first few years of business, we were 100% transactional, no subscriptions. Now we're about 50% subscriptions. And we were able to convince and actually show the leaders of the banks the upside of signing a long-term contract and making it more SaaS-like revenue. And it was a challenge, but people are willing to do it.
Yeah. I mean, as they say, you get what you pay for, right? And so I think there has to be some flexibility, but I think people forget that it's not just the API, right? It's not just the input. It's everything behind it. It's the treasury function. It's the customer success function. It's the compliance function and everything that goes into that. And sometimes if you're not if you're not paying for it, you're not going to get all of that, and then it really hurts later on, and you end up having to find another partner while you're already sailing your ship. So I think that's something you have to definitely weigh out when you're making that decision with a partner.
Yeah, in my mind, the key thing is that your incentives are aligned with your client's incentives, mm-hmm. And for us, what's worked well to enable that is usage pricing. So our measure of usage is the number of small businesses that are connected in any given month for our software. And that means that as our clients grow, then that account will grow with Coda and we can grow with them.
Yep.
And then we combine that with a minimum commitment, mm-hmm. our platform fee. And again, we make sure we're aligned with what our clients want. So startups typically want a very low minimum commitment. They can get up and running quickly. They can improve their product market fit. They don't mind paying a slightly higher per company cost as they get started. And then at the other end of the spectrum, you've got enterprises who want to commit to quite a chunky license upfront, because that gives them security. They can have SLAs associated with that. And in return, they can have a lower unit price,
mm-hmm.
because they can scale much, much faster. And so, using those two components, we can be aligned with our clients and aligned as they grow, and that's worked really well for us.
I also think companies have this tendency when pricing comes up
where it's sort of like a decision paralysis situation where people are afraid that making price decisions are trapdoors and you can't unwind them. And I think it's really important to know that you can change these things. It will upset people. It's going to be okay. They will stick with you. You're not going to lose all your customers. It's just really important to kind of like get past that, because it's really easy to kind of sit and be like, we have to get this perfect the first time. You don't. You're going to screw it up a million times. It's okay. You're gonna adjust. You're gonna react to your customers in the market, and it's gonna be fine. You just have to go for it.
There's an interesting thread I want to double click on around commoditization. So I think there's I've heard this perception in the market that APIs and fintech are increasingly becoming commoditized. Do you agree or disagree? And sort of as a follow-up question, then how do you sort of protect against commoditization when it comes to other competitors in your market?
Yeah, so this is I have strong thoughts here. I reject it pretty much wholeheartedly. I think that the concept so if you take a step back and ask yourself, like, what is an API doing? Like, what is the purpose of what you're building, right? It's an abstraction, and there's a whole bunch, as Kara mentioned, there's a whole bunch going on behind this very simple, elegant abstraction. And how you abstract and what you enable your customers to do with those abstractions, what are the primitives that you are building for others to build on top of, that's where the differentiation is happening. Yes, maybe what is going on when, what does Adyen versus Stripe versus Braintree look like? Like, they're payment processors, yes. There is a commoditized kind of element of that. But how those products are built, how their users interact with them, how easy is it for them to build on top of that, that's where the competitive dynamic comes in. And the concept that pricing is going to go to the floor or is going to kind of hit some kind of like, low level is I don't want to say it's incorrect, but it doesn't have to be that way. You can price yourself premium. You can build your product in a way where you say to others and say, listen, we're not going to price ourselves in a competitive dynamic. We're going to price ourselves premium. And the reason why is because we've built a better product. And if you want a better product, you're going to pay it for it. It is what it is. And so the thing is, what oftentimes happens here is everyone gets in this mindset of, am I building features that get commoditized versus am I building very, very elegant abstractions that make it very easy for your customers to get running? Speed to market to build on top of that is way, way more important than anything else you can do.
Yeah, I 100% agree. I think most markets, there's low risk of commoditization. Like you said, it's experiences you're building on top of the API. It's sometimes the platform or the UI that you're giving to the developer on top of that. And you see that, if you can win early on, you can get pretty sticky contracts with developers. I mean, if your product's good, no matter what you price it, you can price it to the moon, no one's going to churn, the product's going to be really, really good, to your point. I think you do see some commoditization in very, specific use cases where, say, someone's replacing a purely manual process and just getting an API endpoint. Mm-hmm. You're not doing anything on top of that. You're not getting any other experience. You're just replacing one manual piece. That could be commoditized, potentially. Sure. But to your point, if you create enough experience around it, you can really not be commoditized.
Yeah. Makes sense. I want to kind of go into a little bit of a separate thought around the structure and management and tracking kind of KPIs, a little bit tactical. I said, what were some of the main KPIs that your business teams tracked when they started versus what they track now? And how did you go about setting those as kind of the main KPIs for an infrastructure business?
I think one of the main KPIs we tracked in the early days was revenue, that does set the direction of the company. We have a large sales team as an example, and I think setting a revenue target at the company level that helps set that direction. As we've evolved and described our pricing, focus has been much more around usage, mm-hmm. Because that's actually how we drive revenue longer term. So I think that boils down to kind of client success teams, for example, and making sure that they're focused on not necessarily the contracts that are in place, but helping our clients to get the most from our products, to be able to connect as many small businesses as possible, and in turn, those small businesses get value and code out benefits in the longer term.
yeah, we also very revenue focused, of course. And I think that that's good and all, right? And I think there was flexibility to say, hey, like, however you want to hit that revenue target, but making sure along the way you're sort of tracking, like, what goes into that revenue, right? So is it ARR? Is it that flow? Is it the transaction revenue? What are the number of units it took to get to that revenue, and what were the resources that went into that? We also have a really strong marketing organization, and so we're really looking at it holistically in terms of, like, funneling it down from marketing to SDR to sales, and then on the account side as well, really making sure that we're looking at NPS, churn, different types of, retention types of things as well, because that's so important in terms of how we grow our revenue, in terms of the flow and the transaction revenue in the long term.
Yeah, that's interesting. I think, something that I thought that I learned from my Plaid days, we actually didn't focus extremely diligently on revenue early on. But I think kind of following what both Pete was talking about around usage, I think our whole thesis was around if we expand out the sort of number of nodes that we connect into, which is bank accounts linked, that's the primary driver of revenue and future growth for us. And to a certain extent, it's also easier for us to translate the impact of that to our product engineering teams. It's much easier to say API traffic versus times this rate times XYZ. But over time, we just have to optimize that. That was interesting.
Yeah, I think the way to think about it is, to some extent, it's sort of like a working backwards mechanism. Yeah. It's like, what are your goals for this year? And then what are the metrics that you want to measure to help you make sure that you're going to get to that goal?
Yeah.
Right? And I think, like, depending on what your business model is, if it's a usage-based or transaction-based business, the metrics are going to be different than if it's if it's something else. But I think one thing that I would say for anyone who's building infrastructure, particularly an API, like, I think your uptime is frankly the most important metric that you're going to have. And I think, like, whatever scale you think you need to build to, it's 100x what it needs to be, right? Like you're going to grow faster than you think, and if you want to be able to scale to the next 5, 6, 7, 10 years, you should be building now towards that versus waiting until you break and your customers fail you.
That's a really good point. And I think another thing to think about too is if you have big sites ahead and you're looking at expanding globally as a business, it's really easy to just get so focused on revenue and putting all your resources towards that. But it's really important to take a step back and be a bit strategic in your OKRs as well. Like, so for example, if you're like, hey, we're investing in a brand new locale, which is totally different, right? What does that actually look like, and how are you going to make sure that gets prioritized just as equally as your existing revenue? And so I think creating those side OKRs alongside of revenue is really important so that you're focusing on that expansion.
Well, so you brought up OKRs. So I have to, whatever. I feel that everyone loves frameworks on decisioning and goal setting. So I'm curious as to how did you all approach your frameworks around goal setting, OKRs, other structures, business equations? Sort of what were things at different stages of the company that you used that worked well, that didn't work well?
Yeah, one thing that I learned or that I thought worked really well at Stripe, certainly specific, but we had a long-range plan that was sort of this, like, 5 to 7 year arc of what the company was trying to do. And so every year, the company got together and wrote this out, like, actually put together this document that was sort of a living, breathing document. And, what that kind of evolved to based on each year, what our goals are, et cetera, we kind of worked backwards and kind of, said these are the things we need to do to make sure that we can get to that place in 5 years. And so that was one thing that I thought worked really well. Stripe is not an OKR place, it didn't really fit the culture, but that was kind of one way we sort of like try to keep the boats all rowing in the same direction.
Interesting.
Yeah.
We moved from like a concept of OKRs, which I still think work for many companies, to DRI as a fully familiar directly responsible individual, where we just have every single major project, revenue moving, non-revenue moving, and there's an individual responsible for every single one where you can go point to them and ask them what are the current metrics, what's the timeline, et cetera, et cetera. And individualizing the different projects like that has been really helpful.
Why did you guys decide to shift from OKRs to a different structure to this DRI structure?
We found that it was just becoming a little bit redundant, which, a lot of what we're doing in OKRs is really projects, right? Get this customer live, create this new product, et cetera, et cetera. And it seemed a bit, just for our company, the way we were split up, it was just a little bit over bureaucratic, and we simplified a little bit.
That makes sense. Pete Carr, I think.
Well, I think
the main thing is to have a company vision and a North Star that everyone is aligned, can be long-term, to this is what we're trying to do. And then, you know, break it down and have really clear goals and not too many of them, and so they can be remembered by everybody for that period of time. And they've got to stay front of mind, because if they're, you know, written down somewhere and they're only referred, you know, back to at the end of the quarter, they lose their value. And so trying to be as simple and as clear as possible is what's worked well for us.
And if you were talking to a founder who's kind of starting an API infrastructure company today, what would you tell them to watch out, think about? What are the top things that you would want to kind of chat through?
Customer integration cycles. I mean, your customers are developers, so you're going to fall into EPD cycles, right? You're going to get prioritized against other internal products, which is okay. You just have to be aware of it. And the plus side is, even if it gets slowed down by, you know, EPD priorities of your customer, you're usually going to see a lot of stickiness. Mm-hmm. That's a really great thing about API businesses, is if the developers love it and it's taking a long time to implement, like, you're not going to get taken out for a long time. And developers being your primary audience is also really exciting, but also, you know, can be hard for new folks going in. And really focusing all about developer education and documentation, everything around education at the beginning, rather than waiting for it later.
Yeah. I think when you're building a product that is infrastructure, and making sure that it does a few things excellently, like as you know, best in class, is really important. I think the dangerous place to be is when you have a product that does a bunch of things okay. I think it's a disaster zone, frankly. I think it's really important to have things where you say, like, we do these things really well, and as a result of that, we have personas that we're selling to, and that we know that we can make it work. Mm-hmm. And without that, I think it's a really tough place to find your footing on and go to market.
Yeah.
On the same point, in terms of focus, pick a niche in your customer base, mm-hmm. and solve their problems really, really well, and then expand. And so for us, that looked like small business lenders. In fact, a particular niche for invoice finance, small business lenders. Mm-hmm. And then we've expanded out into use cases and clients now that are very, very different to that. But we managed to, you get traction and you get those feedback loops going. With a set of customers who you really understand, and we solve their problem really, really well. And I think we've been very led by our clients in our product development, but you've got to pick those clients very well and be deliberate about it. If you, enterprise customers generalizing, their requests are more incremental, whereas maybe a startup with high potential has got some more innovative ideas that they're mm-hmm. like you to build out. Yep. And that can make a big difference to your trajectory in terms of which clients you optimize for in the early days.
Yep. I think in B2B too, one thing that's interesting, there's when you're talking to your customers, there's like a prioritization that happens. And if the thing that you've built isn't solving one of their top three priorities, the probability that they're going to use you long term is pretty low. Like, they're just going to keep on kicking that down the cycle to integrate to you, unless you're solving that specific thing that is a top tier one priority for them. So it's really important to get there and find a way there.
Yeah. Let me. Oh, the card one.
Nope, ditto.
Cool. And I think something that, Carl, actually, you brought this up a little bit earlier too, around the kind of other stakeholders that are involved in the buying process around infrastructure companies. I think there's a common, maybe not common, but I think there's you build it for developers, developers just love it, they'll find it, they'll come, and boom, you have an amazing company. And I think the reality is a little bit farther from that. But curious as to sort of what are the personas that, you know, people as founders should keep in mind of, who else is involved in the buying process, particularly as it relates to the fintech infrastructure, and how do you sort of balance all the various individuals involved in that process?
It really varies depending on what the company does. I mean, I think, like, if you're selling to another infrastructure company, that's going to look very different than selling to a neobank versus selling to, you know, an ARAP company. But I think it's obviously it's always dev, it's always product, it's always a stakeholder at the top, like C-level. But I think that the underrated ones sometimes are the people who might not get as much voice but can definitely put a stick in things like compliance, right, or other roles like that. So I think it's just really important to understand who's actually making the decision from a financial perspective, from the development perspective, and then who do you want to bring on the journey with you to make sure that they feel safe and that this product that they're investing in is going to make them look good out there in the marketplace. So.
Do you all map like orgs? Do you?
Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah, when you're selling to other startups or fintechs, I think sometimes it can be relatively easy, right, in terms of persona. You're selling to a PM or an engineering manager or a CTO. But when you're selling that API to a bank or a large lender, it's a completely different league. And there are, for us, at least five personas. You have the head of product or CTO, but you also have the head of operations. You have the CEO. You have CFO. You have procurement. And they all care about different things, right? The CEO wants to win. The operations head wants to get people in homes for mortgage. Right? They're thinking about very different, and the procurement just doesn't want to spend too much money, right? So all very different things, and we found that mapping has been game-changing to go into the enterprise.
I think as we go up in terms of the size of company that we're selling to, it's the champion who's really passionate about using our technology is less and less someone technical and more someone on the business side who has trying to grow their top line and hold some type of P&L type responsibility and the budget associated with that. The technical stakeholders always have that veto card. Mm-hmm. And they can torpedo anything as and when they want to, and so they're still, I think, probably the most critical stakeholder to ensure that you're getting buy-in and they're really passionate about your product. But you then also got to convince someone more on the business side to associate the relevant budget for it.
Mm-hmm. Developers are always your champion, I think. I mean, and bringing the rest of the organization along on that journey. Yeah.
Yeah, no, I think that's been obviously a very big shift for the past 5 to 10 years or so, sort of the developer and the technical team as a key buyer of the process. I think banks are probably still catching up a little bit. I think technology can sometimes seem a little bit more back office, middle office versus front office, but I think that's obviously very changing.
This is why I think I beat this drum a lot, but it's why I think it's really important that the speed in which your customers can get moving on your product is so important because the developer is likely a key influencer in that decision. And so what oftentimes happens is if you get someone building in your sandbox or you get someone building and messing around, if they've built an MVP already, it's so much easier for that decision to happen in the business side, right? Because it's like, look, I've already done 2/3 of the work.
Yeah.
It works for X. Just go for it, right?
Yeah. So. Yeah, I mean, like one of the KPIs that we had early on at Plaid for our sales team wasn't contract sign, wasn't speed of signing an MSA. It was basically getting them built.
Yeah.
Time to first API call. Yep. We knew that if we could get them to build in our sandbox and just send an API request, that deal was probably 70-80% chance we're going to close that. It was a different optimization matrix for us. I kept touching upon that. I think some of your companies also kind of start a little bit more mid-market, sales heavy. Others, like Stripe, much more kind of developer-first, self-service. How do you think about sort of the role of a self-service environment, depending on the client segments, and what are things that you've learned as you've gone up-market away from self-service and potentially kind of down-market building a self-service product and how sort of your business team should be thinking about that?
Yeah, I mean, this is one of the things that I think we have done pretty well. We started with a very large base of self-service users, and to start there, actually, for us, we're verifying income, so it's operations people at a bank. And we started, now we have 100,000 operators using the platform. And when you go tell an API to the technical team, you're showing how much the operations team's already getting value out of it. So that's one piece of self-service. And then the second piece, I think, is what was mentioned before, is the idea of developers being able to get into a sandbox really easily in a self-service way, so that when you are selling the CTO, your team's already using it. Like, here's the data. This is how it's actually changed your processes already. So as much as you can make it really, really easy within seconds to get on the sandbox and start calling your API, it's going to have game-changing impact down the line when you're selling to the executive team.
Yeah. And I think the obvious self-service is nice because you don't have a sales team. You get a lot more like revenue leverage when you're scaling, right? Like that's the obvious thing. But I think one thing that's a little bit maybe not talked about a lot is when you have self-service, particularly when it's very easy and your customers do a bunch of use case development for you, where they will take the square peg and they will try to put it in the round hole a million times, and it will work a bunch. And all of a sudden, your use case of your product starts to proliferate in a very, very aggressive fashion.
Yeah.
And you look at the companies that have been successful on the infrastructure side, that's how a lot of their revenue use cases have expanded. It's because the customers have come to them and said, by the way, I took X, I used it for Y, and I will pay you more money because of that. It's invaluable.
That's a really good point. Yeah, I think from that perspective, I think it's good to have both approaches, because I think self-service is one thing, and that's super, super important, like getting into the sandbox, being able to test your use case, but and that just helps the sales side too, and I think it really actually helps you drive up those contract values, and because they start to understand the mistakes that they might be making, or the support that they, or the person they haven't hired to think about that thing that, you know, hasn't been built out, and so and really understanding the value, again, of not just the API, but the entire platform that's behind that API, and some of the services that are provided. One thing that we always do is, regardless, we always assign a solutions person to every early stage deal, because we want to make sure that person feels supported and guided through that self-service process, so that they're getting all their questions answered. And again, taking that feedback loop internally and saying, hey, look at what we just learned over here, and how can we better build our documentation and better build our go-to-market for that use case specifically.
I think it does matter, real quick, on whether you start enterprise first and try to go,
yep.
I think it's much harder to start enterprise first and build a self-serve product than go the other way.
Interesting. Why is that?
You build an organization that is revolved around white glove sales experiences, and it's really hard to change the cultural mentality, both from a product perspective and a go-to-market perspective, to all of a sudden have this thing that sits on its own and generates revenue without people being assigned to it. I won't name names, but there are companies that are out there that have built what I would describe as more enterprise-facing products. They have tried to go more developer-oriented, and they have not figured it out yet. And their lunch is being eaten from the bottom up.
Mm-hmm. So we've gone enterprise down, and I think what's quite nice is being able to combine that white glove kind of experience with the self-service model. So, and for us, what that looks like is as people build new use cases, and the use case expansion really resonated with me. As an example, we had a client recently sign off to start using us to estimate the carbon produced by SMBs, which is not something that we would have ever imagined, but that's a great expansion of our market for us. But as these companies get started themselves, and then they start to grow in terms of usage, then we can reach out and provide that same white glove service that, you know, we've got a good muscle for because we've been doing it with our enterprise clients for some time, and then really make those clients successful on the platform. And I think that's the key with that self-serve model is, you know, the companies that are going to be forever small are not as interesting for us. That's not who we're trying to target. It's the companies who are going to be temporary small and will be the Robin Hood to Plaid, or Revolut for currency cloud, who are going to, you know, really grow, and you can grow with them.
I think both are really hard. I mean, starting self-service and getting enterprise, or starting enterprise and getting self-service are both very, very hard. I'm a big fan of if you can early on bring some mid-market people because they're going to behave more like enterprise and be easier to close when you have your self-service business. But I just think both are challenging.
Okay, so on the flip side, what's been the most challenging going from self-service to enterprise?
Yeah, I mean, it's a different ballgame completely. You have to have security certs, just legitimacy of a brand to sign a big bank, a lot more regulatory pressure. I think generally you have to be a more built-out organization with a lot of case studies. Mm-hmm. And getting that first enterprise can be challenging when all you have are really small customers. So I think it's just that legitimacy, preparedness, preparation for getting a large enterprise.
I'm curious around how have you all approached or thought of, if you were to kind of go back and revisit sort of your go-to-market strategy for the past 3-4 X amount of years, what would you say you all did really, really well and executed really well on? And what would you potentially do sort of differently?
Probably a lot of things, but.
Sure. I'll tackle this one. What we did really well was understanding the ecosystem. I think really understanding not just what problem you're trying to solve, but like your clients and what they're trying to solve, and not just like what are they trying to solve for the market, but like what are they trying to solve in terms of using all these different disparate partners and trying to mash them all together into one really good customer experience. And the more that you can align yourself with those different ecosystem partners, again, especially like, and this is very North American view just because I'm, that's, you know, where I'm based, but I think with you know, cross-border, that's not 80% of what a customer is going to do. But it's that 20% that's so important to them. When that goes wrong, it's a really, really big deal, right? And it's a huge revenue driver, too. So from our perspective, I think that's what we did really, really well is, like, really align ourselves to the ecosystem. I think what we could have done better is this was touched on before, is focus faster. Say, like, these are the sub-segments we want to be in. These ones we're not going to touch, and, like, go all in on that. I think we took a bit of a, like, let's see, like, where we should be, you know, where's the most value, and like, and then that's a tough one because then you're kind of servicing customers across all these different subsegments, and so that we've definitely gotten better at in terms of really being diligent about where we're focusing, but I think we could have done that faster.
I was going to say, I mean, I guess like one thing we've done well is a self-service enterprise transition. One thing we could have done better on selling to enterprises is transitioning from solution-based selling to the challenger sale, which we've started only doing recently and has an incredible impact. Have our CRO in the audience who kind of helped educate on it. But really, instead of spending all your time qualifying the customer and figuring out what their problems are and their ideal solution, instead of walking in there as an expert and saying, okay, I understand your problem. We're actually the experts here. This is how we're going to solve it together. Here's exactly how, and this is by when. And bring a lot of that confidence in rather than just saying, hey, what can I do for you? What can I do for you? Because that's going to be a never-ending process. You're going to keep on asking more and more. But if you actually say, we're the expert, we actually know a lot more than you do about this specific problem, and we're going to show you how, we found it a lot more impactful.
I think my experience at Stripe, the things we did well, I think on the self-serve side, I think Stripe really figured out a very efficient way to get developers to just build on the product like very easily. I mean, there was no, for the first 5-6 years, I mean, Stripe had no marketing. It was basically just writing things on Hacker News. Like Patrick would go to Hacker News and write like, hey, we launched this, and all of a sudden, we'd have 1,000 new signups, right? I mean, that, and he really kind of like found him. It's part of it's his personality, but it's also his sort of like reputation in the developer community. Like he could do that, and I think CEOs that have others an advantage there. Things that we could have done better. I think when we started to move from self-serve, lower market to the enterprise process, I think we sort of we misunderstood a couple things, specifically things that seemed rather trivial to us from like developer-oriented mentality, but when you're an enterprise, like you care about things like your auth rates to the basis points, right? Like that stuff matters, and I think Stripe didn't really get that right away, and so there was some misses where we would go and try to win major enterprise deals where we just didn't have the lexicon or the product framing to compete where we needed to.
Yeah, then we had a lot of learnings on when we did our first RFP. We're like, oh, we're going to crush this. We have the best product. We know why we're going to do it. And it turns out, oh, great. No, the way that this client thought about how they structured or why they structured, and a lot of it was, we think you're wrong. But the way this RFP set up is completely wrong, but that's just how you've been doing it for the past 10, 15, 20 years. And it has to follow that process to a certain extent. You have to figure out how you fit in into the buying cycle of your enterprise. It's a pretty eye-opening experience for me.
I think that's one of our learnings is, we had one product that did everything for too long, and actually splitting that into 4 or 5 products allowed our clients to better understand the value that we could provide them for different use cases. Mm-hmm. And that's been transformation. I think as a developer, having one product was very simple and it had that appeal. But yeah, splitting out into more products earlier would have been an advantage for us.
makes sense. All right, let's go to some fun topics. What is overhyped in fintech right now?
How controversial would you think?
Yeah, you can pick. We can overindex on there, but you pick.
I find the emphasis on regulation, especially open banking, to be a bit overhyped. I think in this country, these things move very slowly, and I'm not sure how much impact it will have on our day-to-day lives anytime in the next few years. But I think there's just so much discussion and kind of FUD around how it's going to change the industry, and I'm not sure if the hype is there.
Mm-hmm. All ruffles and feathers. I think crypto is...
Oh, boy. Okay. Uh-oh.
Fighting words.
...is a little bit overhyped. Not that there isn't value there, and all the companies in the space will be successful, but just the amount of focus and investment at the moment, I think, is a little bit overhyped.
Valuations?
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I mean, I think... We're in an interesting time right now where I do think the concept of embedded fintech is a little bit, not just overhyped, but it's the name has been bastardized a little bit.
Yeah.
French, but it's sort of, I think we're in a place where, yes, infrastructure is important and it enables a lot of new things to be done, but everything doesn't need to have an API built into it, and you should be thoughtful about what you're doing when you think about that.
Yeah, you know, I think I would probably pick something similar where I think there's been a lot of infrastructure that's made it significantly and drastically easier to build financial products, but I still think it's still a non-trivial exercise to decide to launch a financial services product where... great. You can probably outsource your compliance, you can outsource legal, you can outsource regulatory, but at some point you can't. At some point something goes wrong. You have
some
business.
Cases you actually can't. You can't.
Some
compliance things are they're non-reliant.
Right. And I think building out that muscle, I think that's something I've been spending a lot of time on with kind of non-fintech companies. Of, I just want to launch a card. No, it turns out I need to have a compliance team. I need to have we're suspicious transactions being reviewed, and we can file SAR reports now, and that's a whole muscle. We've never hired anyone for this team. And we also need a legal team that actually understands how to talk to these contracts and set all that up, and it's a pretty non-trivial exercise. So I'd probably pick something similar. On the flip side, what's underhyped in fintech then?
Well, let's take the opposite and say crypto. I think, especially today, it's very, very crazy times we're living in, and not being a crypto company myself, it took me a little bit to come around to NFTs. But I really, really think we should all be paying very close attention to them. I think, as we've seen with every new technology, especially in crypto, there's always a bubble at the beginning, and the bubble will die out. The NFTs are here for the long term. And there's a lot of reasons why I go into, I mean, I think digital art has been incredibly undervalued for a long time. But I think for us in traditional fintech, we really should pay attention to what can be built on top of NFTs. If it's a real asset class, we need to start maybe lending against that asset class. Maybe we need to start verifying that asset class and apply to loans. I mean, there's so many different implications if you believe NFTs are here to stay. And I really do think they are. And I think they're, in fact, even a little underhyped.
Oh, wow. Okay, interesting. Well, I have some NFTs to sell you, so.
I'm a bit biased, but I think technology that's serving small businesses is underhyped. It's often a little bit less sexy than consumer tech, and I think companies that are maybe more boring don't get so much of the spotlight. Small business technology, maybe in particular some of the accounting software providers, people like Xero and Intuit, as they start to roll out more financial services, I think they'll be ones to watch.
On my same theme, profitability. No, making money, right? Figuring out how to actually...
Yeah, making revenue in the first place.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For me, I would agree on the crypto thing, but maybe from a little bit of a different angle. I just think that you have a situation where it's very obvious. Like, if you kind of look back through history and we think about things that have become huge paradigm shifts, like, this is clearly what's happening. Like, the protocols themselves are being utilized to build things that did not and could not exist before. And so the enablement factor here, to me, is what's, I think, just, you know, it's certainly hot right now, and there will be ups and downs, but if we look over this from a 30-year to 40-year, 50-year arc for, like, a technology shift, like, we're very clearly in probably the first inning of things. And so I think you just have to pay attention, and making long-term bets and going with the ups and downs is going to be part of the process.
Yeah. I guess last question I have for now, in terms of, so what areas of infrastructure in fintech do you think are you most interested, excited by, or excited to see more people building in?
For me, payments. I think there's, and especially payments around small businesses, I think is still a huge opportunity. And so that's what's most exciting for me.
What do you think are some of the big pain, like the pain areas, right? If you had to highlight a few, and for, specifically for SMBs around payments, what are some interesting things to investigate into?
I think it's the automation around accounts payable and accounts receivable, and tying that payment infrastructure into the other applications that SMBs use. That, I think, is still a lot of efficiency to be gained there, and that'll make a huge difference to small business owners.
For me, I think the concept of a ledger is incredibly important, and is going to be continue to be, like, whether it's payments, whether it's crypto, like building a ledger. Anyone who's a developer who's been inside of a company that's tried to build their own ledger, it's an incredibly difficult process. It is, like, really cumbersome. The mistakes that you can make are costly because it ties into your accounting and finance systems. It kind of ties into your product itself as you're relying on it. And so I'm really excited about folks that are sort of building around that area.
I think for me, being in the cross-border payment space, RegTech still, there's a long way to go in terms of using technology to help reduce the number of people you need in the back office. From that perspective, same thing on the operations and treasury management side. So any tools that can continue to come out to help there, and really think about the edge cases and the different use cases that can come out of it.
Yeah, I mean, bias coming from my role, but I think data infrastructure, we're going to continue to see change drastically over the next few years, next 5 years, where we've had, you know, legacy institutions running data infrastructure in this country for almost 100 years. And we're now seeing that shift, given more everything in the financial system is moving online. You also need online APIs for the data, and a lot of people in this room are focused on that. But I think there's going to continue to see new and new use cases, whether it's synthetic data or not, where the APIs are going to replace the legacy institutions that were providing the data before.
Actually, last question. I feel so. Last question. I think there's been a lot of discussion around, you know, the past 10, 20 years was sort of like the rise of SaaS and kind of SaaS multiples. I think we're starting to see some interesting activity within API infrastructure companies, right, with Twilio going to market, Datadog sort of usage base and premiums associated there. What do you think comes next after APIs? Like, what else is, what is sort of like the next phase, or do we sort of go back again and do SaaS by APIs back and forth? Kind of a tough question, but just curious.
I mean, I think, I don't know if it's the right trend, but we're seeing the orchestration layer, like the API of APIs happening. I'm sort of torn sometimes. Like, it's sort of one of those things where it's interesting that it's happening, but in a lot of cases, I'm not sure it's the right solution for the problem they're trying to solve. In some cases, it is. It depends. But I think that's a very fascinating thing. You have people building APIs to aggregate APIs. Like, that's kind of amazing.
Yeah.
I think in terms of an evolution from providing the kind of the technical layer, the data layer, into providing kind of the business decisions. For clients directly. So I think lots of our clients, and lots of clients, are very interested in the data that we make available. We see more and more requests to, okay, the data's great, but help us understand what that really means.
Yeah.
And kind of coming in at a slightly higher level, I guess, often by aggregating APIs at the same time, I think that's the next kind of evolution, certainly in our space.
Yeah, I was going to say, it's like two points. The layer on top of the API is also the UI, I would say, and maybe we're going more towards a low-code, no-code world of APIs, where someone can really get a lot of value of the API without actually coding. We can just drag and drop a few things on the screen. So I think this would be really powerful if we get really no-code type of APIs, and we're seeing some other examples of that.
Awesome. All right, I think we're good. Thanks so much for hopping on. Thanks, everyone, for listening. And we'll stick around for a bit for questions. But thanks, everyone.
Thank you, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder, please remember to wear your mask and socially distance when possible, and remain wearing your masks unless you're eating or drinking. We will see you back here this afternoon for a fireside chat with Tom Adams and Joshua Silver, beginning at 3 p.m.
Watch it burn. Oh, but I'm not that old, young. But I'm not that bold. I don't think the world is sold. I'm just doing what we're told.